grace to you in peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us. That's what Father Abraham has to say in today's parable. And it was true then, and it was true earlier in our own history. During World War I, there was a Protestant chaplain with the American troops in Italy who became a really good friend with a local Roman Catholic priest. In time, of course, the Protestant chaplain moved on with his unit and, unfortunately, was killed in the midst of combat. Well, the priest heard about his friend's death, and so he asked the military authorities if it was possible for him to bury his friend's body in his church's cemetery. And the army said sure. The army gave its permission, but the priest ran into a problem with the church's authorities. Oh, they were very and sincerely sympathetic, but they said that they simply could not approve the burial of a non-Catholic person in a consecrated Catholic cemetery. So the priest buried his friend's body just outside the cemetery's fence. Well, years later, an American veteran made a sentimental journey back to Italy and back to that same area, back to that same small town. He knew what had happened earlier in that village, and so he went to visit the old priest who was still serving the parish in that same small village. And the first thing that the veteran asked that priest was to see the grave of that Protestant chaplain. So they walked out to the cemetery, and the veteran was surprised to find that the grave was now inside the fence. "Oh," he said, "I see that you finally got permission to move the body." "Oh, no," said the priest. "They told me where I couldn't bury the body, but nobody ever told me that I couldn't move the fence." And so he had. Between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, said Father Abraham. It was true then, and in many ways, it is still true today. In one form or another, there are still great chasms all over the place that separate all sorts of people for all sorts of different reasons. And far too often, we and others not only help to create the chasms, but we help to maintain them, we help to solidify them, we help to build them up, we help to set them in stone, it would seem. These kinds of chasms, canyons, if you will, valleys, divides, they can be created anywhere, anytime, for any reason, by any person. And once they're created, there's simply something about them that causes them to be among the deepest, the most difficult things to deal with of all the other chasms that might exist. There's something about these kinds of chasms that make us want to build walls to support them rather than to build bridges to cross them. And these kinds of chasms are still being created anytime, anywhere, for any reason, by any person. They can be and still are sometimes created between children and parents, between husbands and wives, between ex-husbands and ex-wives, between one race or one sex or one nation or one church and someone else. They can be created these days between straights and gays, between neighbors, between friends, between co-workers, between church members, between generations, of all things, between political parties, if you can believe it. They can be created between the haves and the have-nots. They can be created between the urban areas of a city and between the suburbs. They can be created between our own expectations for ourselves and our own experience. created sometimes for good reasons and sometimes for bad ones. They're created sometimes for reasons that are understandable and for reasons that simply defy all logic. They're sometimes created out of anger, sometimes out of conscience. Sometimes they're created to make a statement. Sometimes they're created just to be stubborn. Of all the abilities that people have been given, people like us and others seem to have almost been cursed with the ability to create these deep and great chasms. And once they're created, you and I know that they seem to hurt us as much as they hurt the people they're intended to hurt. And yet, day after day, week after week, we and other people simply keep creating them. And once they're created, they're always so difficult to fill in or to get across. And the longer that they exist, the more impossible that task seems to become. And yet, despite that fact, despite what we know to be true, we and others keep creating them. And all of that can leave us feeling pretty pessimistic and feeling pretty helpless about all the chasms that do exist in our lives and in our world and in our communities. And yet there are things that can make a difference to us in the midst of our hopelessness and pessimism. Things like a picture that I remember seeing years ago, a picture that was taken after the death of the former Governor George Wallace. In the picture, his casket, the one burying his body, was being carried out of the Alabama State House after it had laid there in state. Now mind you, here was the man who was the very poster boy for segregation. Here was the man who chose indeed to stand in the doorway of a schoolhouse rather than to let African-American students attend what had been an all-white school. This is who George Wallace had been. And yet, in this picture, we see that his honor guard, those men and women who were carrying his casket, they consisted of both white state troopers and African-American state troopers. In the picture, we see that right behind his casket walked a white minister and an African-American minister. That was true not just because times had changed, although that was true. That picture told that story because of a literal conversion that same man, George Wallace, had experienced in his own life, especially as it had to do with people of other colors. But there are still chasms all around us. So we wonder, can anyone help us with all these chasms that exist in our families, all these chasms that exist in our communities, that exist in our world, that exist within our own hearts and souls? Well, yes, says Jesus. I can do that. Can anyone help us with all the hostility that can exist within our own families and within our own communities and our own world and our own hearts and souls? Yes, says Jesus, I can do that. Can anyone redesign the patterns of how we think and feel and act so that our own lives can be used to build bridges instead of walls? Well, yes, says Jesus, I can do that. And that's good news for us still, because chasms can be and are built anytime, anywhere, for any reason, by any person. They can cause great pain, and they can seem impossible to overcome. But Jesus can do just that. In fact, Jesus promises to do just that. In fact, Jesus offers to do just that. In fact, in us and through us, Jesus is doing just that for us and for all people. For the one that we know who is the Prince of Peace now promises to be our peace, to be peace for us and a peace for all those people who are on the other side of our chasms, no matter who those other people might be, and no matter what has caused the chasm to be created, He who is our peace promises to be peace for us and for them. And the one who has already laid his life down once for all now promises to lay himself down in our lives, like a bridge over troubled water, as the old song goes, like a bridge over whatever kind of chasm may and does exist. Now, Father Abraham was not too optimistic in today's parable. Between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, he said, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us. No one can cross, he said. Simply, it can't be done. Do it, says Jesus. I can help to build bridges over whatever chasms may exist. I can tear down whatever walls have been built. No one can do that, Father Abraham said. I can do it, Jesus said. In fact, I am doing it now. Your life and mine, and through us, in the lives of all the people all around us. I can do it, Jesus says. I can do it. Amen. Please stand as we sing this.